Welcome to Smart News Digital. The news articles that we are going to discuss today, the 21st of September 2018, today are the following eight. Let's see them in detail. The first article is for liberty's sake on the scope of Article 32 in the activist case. Recently, we have seen that the Pune police have arrested about five activists which has violated the personal liberty of the activist. Now, Supreme Court have intervened in this case to the rescue of the activist. The Supreme Court on Thursday have stated that the Maharashtra court to hand over the entire case diary, which has led to the government stating that the activists have been part of Maoist plot on life of the sovereign head, and which has eventually led to the crackdown of the activist. The Supreme Court has reserved its decision and has one of the following three courses of action to take. The first one is to allow the police in Maharashtra to pursue the investigation against the activists who are allegedly being members of the outlawed CPI Maoist and also have joined a conspiracy against the government. The second one is to set them at liberty on the ground that this is a trumped up case, that is a cooked up case. And the third one is to order a probe by an independent team as like a CBI or an NIA. Now this case has thrown a legal tussle between the center's contention and the counter arguments from the activist. The center has stated that it has been probing the terrorist conspiracy involving Maoist insurgents and their urban supporters in the form of the activists. But the activists state that this is a thinly disguised crackdown on the political dissent. Now, by admitting this petition from the activists, so the Supreme Court has set a stage for the examination of some fundamental questions which are at the intersection of criminal procedure and the constitutional law. Now, the procedural question here is whether in a criminal matter, the court can entertain a petition under Article 32 of the Constitution, which deals with the constitutional remedies, for which the accused are expected to seek remedy from Criminal Procedure Code of India. And the substantial question here is whether the Supreme Court should intervene when the liberty of the citizens and their right to dissent are sought to be denied by the police action. And it is against this backdrop that Supreme Court had decided to examine the case diary to whether the charges by the police has some basis for arresting the activists. But in this case, the government may have reason to worry that it might send a wrong precedent that every accused can rush to the Supreme Court immediately on their arrest. It should be noted here that it is unusual that one city police, that is a Pune police, to investigate a crime that is supposedly spans several states. This is because due to the alleged Maoist plot stated by the government. Now, it is important for the Supreme Court to decide on the probe and think of handling it to an independent organization like CBI or NIA for a fair probe. The second article we are going to see today is Moon Diplomacy on the Korean Peace Process. This article deals with the visit of South Korean President Moon Jae-in to North Korea and the subsequent show of unity by the two countries. While traveling to Pyongyang, Mr. Moon had two main goals to fulfill. One is to revive the talks between US and North Korea over denuclearization, and the next one is to infuse fresh positivity into the North-South Korean relationship. Now, during this visit, the agreement signed where the North Korea agreed to shut down its Tongjang-ri missile testing site in the presence of international observers as per the international norms. And the second one is to dismantle the Yongbyang nuclear facility if the US takes corresponding measures to better the ties between US and North Korea. The North and South Korea have also agreed to open a facility in southeastern North Korea where the divided families between the North and South can hold reunions. As a continuation of the peace process, Mr. Kim of North Korea have promised to visit Seoul at an early date for further negotiations on the peace process. Now this summit between North and South Korea has been seen positively by the US, and it has also expressed its readiness to immediately engage with North Korea in talks. But it is to be understood that the core issues still remain, that is the critical issues like denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. Also, North Korea wants US to formally declare an end to the Korean War for it to make any more concessions. In the last few months, we have seen that Mr. Kim of North Korea appears to be consistent in his pursuit of peace and global recognition. Now it is time for the heads of US and South Korea to reciprocate the actions of North Korea and take concrete steps for lasting peace in the Korean Peninsula. third article for the day is protecting persons with HIV or AIDS. Recently, India had enacted HIV/AIDS Prevention Control Act of 2017, which safeguards the human rights of people who are living with HIV and AIDS. Now, in this regard, the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare are issued a notification which makes the act coming into force September 10 of this year. We have seen that this act was born out of urgent need for preventing and controlling the virus and its syndrome. This act has also highlighted necessity for effective care, support and treatment for HIV and AIDS patients. Also, by enacting this act, India has reiterated its commitment to the global community under the Declaration of Commitment of HIV and AIDS 2001. The acts list various grounds on which discrimination against persons infected with HIV is prohibited. It states that denial, termination, discontinuation, or unfair treatment with regards to unemployment, educational establishments, and services like healthcare and insurance cannot be violated for the persons infected with HIV. The Act also states that requirement of HIV testing as a prerequisite for obtaining employment and healthcare facilities is also prohibited. The Act provides every HIV patients or affected persons below 18 years of age the right to reside in the shared household, and they cannot be discriminated or stigmatized on this. One other important provision of this act is it prohibits any individual from publishing information or advocating feelings of hatred against the persons infected with HIV and AIDS. And violation of this provision under section 37 of the act states that it is punishable with term of imprisonment, which extends up to 2 years from 3 months, and also a fine of about 1 lakh. As per the provisions of the Act, every person in care and custody of the state shall have the right to HIV prevention, testing, treatment and counseling services, which is very important for patients living with HIV and AIDS. The fourth article for the day is duty to defend. Now, recently, Rewari and Kausli Bar Associations in Haryana have passed resolutions that none of the members of its bar will defend the accused in recent case of gang rape of a teenager in Rewari district of Haryana. Now, this article has stated that this resolution is wholly illegal and goes against the decision of Supreme Court in the A.S. Mohammed Rafiq vs. State of Tamil Nadu case in 2010. Now, in this Mohammed Rafiq case, Supreme Court had declared null and void a resolution of the Coimbatore Bar Association, which had stated that none of its members will defend the police who had allegedly assaulted some lawyers. In this case, the Supreme Court had also declared that such resolutions are against the professional ethics of the lawyers. The court also observed that any person, how much ever wicked he might be, has a right to be defended in the court of law, and it is the duty of the lawyer to defend him in that court. The author of the article also quotes Thomas Erskine, the famous Attorney General of Prince of Wales, that if an advocate refuses to defend, he assumes the character of the judge, which is against the rule of law of the land. Now, the author of the article had stated the previous instances where the Indian lawyers have defended various accused in various cases, as like the revolutionaries of Bengal during British rule, the Indian communists who were charged in the Meerut conspiracy case, the Razakas of Hyderabad, Sheikh Abdullah of Jammu and Kashmir, an INA accused, and the lawyers had also defended the assassins of the father of the nation, Mahatma Gandhi and Indira Gandhi. And also recently we have seen that people like Binayak Sen, who was charged of sedition, and Ajmal Kasab, who was an accused in 2611 Mumbai blast case, have also been defended by lawyers. The author has also stated that no Indian lawyer of repute has avoided its duty to defend, claiming that it would make him unpopular or personally be dangerous to him. Hence, the author has concluded that the right-minded lawyers of Rewari and Kausli Bar Association has to defend the accused. The fifth article for the day is Sushma to meet Pakistan Foreign Minister in New York. India has accepted Pakistan's proposal for a talks between External Ministers of India, Sushma Swaraj, and the Foreign Minister of Pakistan, Mr. Qureshi, on the lines of the ongoing UN General Assembly in New York. However, India had stated that the talks would not be aimed at broader scheme of dialogue until terror exports from Pakistan is stopped. But it is expected that the issue of Pakistan facilitating visits of Indian pilgrims to Pakistan's Kartarpur Sahib Gurudwara is expected to be discussed. Now let's see the timeline of Indo-Pak peace process in the last 3 years. In December 2015, a comprehensive bilateral dialogue was announced by Foreign Minister Sushma Swaraj. It is to be understood that this dialogue was first in 7 years since the Mumbai blast of 2008. And again, in December 25 of 2015, PM Modi had visited the family event of former Prime Minister of Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif. But subsequently, in Jan 2016, Pathankot attack occurred, which led to the foreign secretary level talks getting delayed. And again in March 2006, Pakistan claimed to have captured Gulbushan Jadhav of India. And again in July 2016, Burhan Wani was killed in Kashmir, and for this, India blamed Pakistan for escalating tension in Kashmir. And this led to 19th SAARC summit getting delayed. Now, after Imran Khan has taken charge as PM of Pakistan, there seems to be thaw in the relationship between India and Pakistan, which must be used carefully by India. The sixth article for the day is Plug Tax Gaps in Consent Route, says SEBI, which is the market regulator of India. Recently, SEBI wants the government to amend the IT Act to plug the loopholes in the consent mechanism. According to the consent mechanism, the entities that settle their respective matters with the SEBI through this mechanism involves paying monetary penalty and stating it as deductible business expense, which will lower their taxable income and thereby their tax liability. But this costs the exchequer of India. And this is a problem which the SEBI wants to address by the government's amendment of the IT Act. SEBI has stated one of the instances where this consent mechanism is used by the company to get tax benefits. In February 2016, the IT department had allowed Anil Ambani to treat Rs. 50 crore he paid as settlement charges to the market regulator as a taxable expenditure. And later on, this decision of the IT officials was upheld by IT Appellate Tribunal. Now, the tax authorities have put forward that the settlement amount was not a penalty and hence it can be treated as deductible business expense. And this is also supported by section of experts that the company should be allowed to treat the settlements amount as an expense since such payouts are part of the compliance cost. But we have seen that in US, such settlement amounts are non-deductible. And this is what Indian SEBI wants to implement as well. This US Securities Exchange Commission had clearly laid down that the applicants cannot seek any kind of tax credit on the amount paid to the regulators. Thus, it is important for the Indian government to look into this issue and take necessary steps so that it balances between the ease of doing business and without costing the exchequer the due tax amount. The next article for the day is Pakistan invites Saudi Arabia to be third partner in CPEs, which is the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Recently, Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan visited Saudi Arabia and UAE, and as a consequence of this visit, he had invited Saudi Arabia to be part of the CPEC with an amount of $50 billion. Now, what is a CPEC? It is a flagship program of multi-billion dollar BRI, which is the Belt and Road Initiative of China. It is a pet project of Chinese President Xi Jinping and which aims at enhancing Beijing's influence around the world through China-funded infrastructure projects. In this regard, further agreements are expected to be signed during Saudi Finance and Energy Minister's visit to Pakistan in October of this year. The BRI project of China has been mired in controversies, stating that it creates debt trap in countries which are involved in this. For example, the Hambantota port of Sri Lanka is also regarded as a debt trap to Sri Lanka. In this way, CPEC is also seen as a debt trap to compromise the cash trap Pakistan's sovereignty. Now let's see the aims of CPEC. It is to construct and upgrade transportation network between Kashgar in China and Gwadar in Pakistan. It also aims at developing energy projects, deep water port in Gwadar and special economic zones in the corridor, and eventually which will lead to Pakistan's industrial development as a manufacturing hub by 2030. In this regard, India has to involve with Saudi Arabia bilaterally and air its concerns about CPEC passing through POK, which affects the sovereignty and security of India. The last article for the day is Sex Offenders Registry launched with 4.4 lakh entries. This registry is a first of a kind initiative in India, which is launched on Thursday. And it has entries of about 4.4 lakh people who have committed offenses since 2005. Certain activists have stated that this sex offenders registry will compromise on the individual's personal liberty and dignity. But the Home Ministry has stated that it will not violate the privacy of the individual. Also, in this event, we have seen that the Home Minister Rajnath Singh had launched another portal, the cybercrime.gov.in, which will receive complaints from the citizens on objectionable online content relating to child pornography, child sexual abuse, and explicit materials on rape and gang rape. Let's see certain important aspects of this registry. This registry will be maintained by National Crime Records Bureau, which will store the data, and it will be accessible only to the enforcement agencies, and it will be out of bounds for the general public. The other countries which had already had this type of database are the US, the UK, the New Zealand, South Africa, and Trinidad and Tobago. The name, address, photograph, and the fingerprint details of the convicts will be stored in this. The duration of storage is about 15 years for those posing low danger and 25 years for those posing moderate level danger. The data of people who are convicted of serious offenses like gang rapes will be in this registry for lifelong. Thank you.